Michael Reynolds is Associate Professor of Near Eastern Studies at Princeton University. He holds a BA from Harvard in Government and Slavic Languages and Literature, an MA in Political Science from Columbia, and a PhD in Near Eastern Studies from Princeton. He's the author of Shattering Empires, The Clash and Collapse of the Ottoman and Russian Empires, 1908 to 1918, a winner of the American Historical Association's George Lewis Beer Prize for International History. His teaching and research interests include Ottoman, Middle Eastern, and Russian and Eurasian history, the Caucasus, international relations, and nationalism. Professor Reynolds is currently at work on a biography of the Ottoman Minister of War and Young Turk, Triumvir Enver Pasha. The subject of Professor Reynolds' presentation is Through Wars Towards the Great War, the Ottomans, and the Vortex of World War I. Will you join me in welcoming Professor Michael Reynolds?
Thank you, Laura, for that introduction, and I'd like to thank the staff of the museum, and George Thompson in particular, for organizing this symposium. I know how much work these sorts of events take, and I'm very grateful for the invitation to speak here today, and of course I'd also like to thank you, the audience, for being here to listen to me speak. I will be speaking on the Ottoman Empire, and I thought maybe the way I should start my talk is why should you listen to a talk about the Ottoman Empire in World War I? There's so many things to discuss. Why the Ottoman Empire? After all, it was not a great power. It's been described, I think, accurately as something closer to a semi-colony. And so why does it deserve attention? For a couple of reasons. I think the first I would point out is that the war, conventional narratives of the outbreak of World War I start in Sarajevo. That is a former Ottoman city. It suggests that maybe the Ottoman Empire and its history, its legacy, might have something to do with the war. Throughout the 19th century, the so-called Eastern question, that is the question of how to divide and partition the Ottoman Empire, was the major diplomatic issue for the great powers. It was a cause of recurring rivalry between the great powers, as I'll be discussing today. And I might also point out, since Syria has already been introduced by Dr. Nyberg, we're still grappling with the legacy of the Ottoman Empire in some ways that are eerily reminiscent of the issues of a century ago. Other set of reasons why I'd say it's important to, it's worthwhile to study the Ottoman role in World War I is that the Ottoman entry into the war exerted a profound impact on the war and perhaps even more importantly on the long-term conflict. This is despite the fact that the Ottomans joined the losing side. So you might be saying, well, why is that? Well, the Ottomans weren't a major power. They joined the war, but they're on the losing side. Are they really that important? Well, I would just point out that the Ottoman entry into the war, contrary to the expectations of many, significantly impacted the duration of the war. General Ludendorff, the German, wrote that, in his estimation, the Ottoman entry into the war prolonged the fighting by at least a year. Now, in addition to prolonging the war, the Ottoman participation in the war also led to the blockade, effective blockade of Russia from the south, that is through the Black Sea Straits. And this extended fighting, coupled with the effect of the blockade on Russia's south, heightened the socioeconomic strain on the Russian Empire during the war, exacerbated the internal crisis that the Russian Empire began to experience, and therefore played a direct role in facilitating the Russian Revolution and the fall of the Tsar in February 1917, which of course opens the way for the Bolshevik Revolution of November 1917. And that, of course, ultimately leads on to the Cold War, et cetera, et cetera. So today I thought I would focus on the questions, why did the Ottoman Empire enter World War I? And then briefly answer the question, and why did it enter on the side of Germany? What did the Ottomans see at stake in this war? Now, the Ottoman entry into the war was not foreordained. In fact, the Ottomans were eager not to enter the war. This was even after establishing their alliance with Germany in August 1914. Moreover, I would contend that the Ottoman decision to join with Germany was not a rash decision motivated by a thirst for expansion or a desire for revenge, as many conventional treatments portray the Ottoman decision. But in fact, I would argue that the Ottoman decision to enter the war on the side of Germany was a strategically sound choice that was informed by the central desire of the empire's leaders to preserve their state and as much of its territory as possible. The leadership of the Ottoman Empire in 1914 saw itself as engaged in an extended struggle for their empire's existence. The World War I was not seen as an aberration in any way, but in fact was seen as, it was almost life as normal for the Ottomans, certainly at least at the beginning of the war. And I should also note that Turkish historiography often discusses this period of history not as, in the period of World War I, is not as a discrete episode in the history of the Ottoman Empire and or Turkey, but rather as part of what's been called the 10 Years' War, that is beginning with the Balkan Wars to the end of what the what contemporary Turkey refers to as its war of liberation. Now, although I'll be speaking about things in very general terms, I thought I would nonetheless start. There's a great deal to be said about the Ottomans in 1914, but just to complicate things a bit for myself, I thought, well, let's start not with the end of the Ottoman Empire, let's actually start with the beginning. So the point I want to make with this map is that the Ottoman Empire and Turkey are not synonymous. This is in European sources, you constantly see this reference to the Ottoman Empire as Turkey. I contend this is both factually incorrect, but also leads us to making a number of conceptual errors. And what I wanted to, in particular, bring out this map of the shows the expansion of the Ottoman Empire. You'll note that the empire, the Ottoman dynasty, is founded in 1299. In this territory here, and as you see, as it begins to expand, what I want to draw people's attention to is the fact that, contrary to I think most people's assumption is that probably the Ottoman Empire began someplace, let's say around Ankara, the current capital of Turkey, or perhaps Konya, that is the interior of Anatolia, and then expanded through the Middle East, and after it has the Middle East at its back, then it launches itself into the Balkans. It's nothing of the sort. As you'll notice, this map very nicely illustrates from the very beginning, the Ottoman Empire was very much a Balkan empire, arguably more of a Balkan empire than it was a Middle Eastern empire, and that the heartland of the empire is here, in the Balkans and Western Anatolia. And this has this is important for understanding the attitude, the mindset of the leadership of the Ottomans in 1914. Now, this map shows the empire essentially as its at its territorial peak, which it reaches in the 16th century, and then, to simplify matters, more or less plateaus, if you will. And it's at the end of the 18th century when the empire really begins to run into problems, when it becomes quite clear that the empire has grown substantially weaker than the European states, weaker than the Austrians, weaker than the Russians, weaker than the British Empire, etc. And it's after they have signed a treaty in 1774 with Russia, the Treaty of Kuchuk-Kanarja, which is the first time where they have to surrender territory, acknowledge formally, I should emphasize more, rather, they have to formally acknowledge that they lost the war. You have Napoleon's invasion of Egypt in 1798, where Napoleon's very easily able to enter Egypt and take it over. These are commonly referred to as turning points, illustrations of the shift in the balance of power between the Ottomans and its European rivals. That kicks off. The Ottomans are very aware of what happens, and beginning at the same period, the end of the 18th century, beginning of the 19th century, the Ottomans engage in a prolonged and sustained and serious, quite serious, reform effort that begins initially with military reforms, and then when they realize that this isn't sufficient, in order to have a European-style army, you really need to have a European-style state and bureaucracies, et cetera. the reforms begin to expand, and sort of there's a snowball effect. Now, as they're trying to carry out these reforms, they get involved in a series of wars, in particular with the Russian Empire, but with others, and they are buffeted constantly from outside. Now, this reform effort arguably culminates in 1876 when the Ottoman Empire adopts a constitution and establishes a parliament. This brief experiment in constitutional rule, however, comes to an end in 1877 with the Russo-Ottoman War of that year, of 1877-1878. The Ottomans lose that war, and in response to the war, the Sultan Abdulhamid II, abrogates the constitution, he shelves it, and shuts down the parliament. So that sort of puts an end to this reform effort. Now, from this war, as this map here demonstrates, the dismemberment of the Ottoman Empire from 1878 to 1913. You'll see these territories here. Kars, Ardahan, Batumi are lost, as is the territories of Bulgaria, Romania, minor sort of border change in with Iran. So this is the final stage of dismemberment of the Ottoman Empire. Now, under the new this Sultan Abdulhamid II, who came to the throne in 1876 and abrogates the constitution, he ruled. Essentially, what he did was he centralized authority under himself. Was known as a despotic leader, and in the view of many of the officers serving in the Ottoman army and many of the young civil bureaucrats who could read European languages, had been abroad, they saw him rather as someone who was not strengthening the empire, but in fact doing precisely the opposite, that through his tight control of the imperial administration, that he was, in fact, condemning the empire to further decline, and ultimately his rule would lead to the empire's extinction. So you have a number of conspiracies that are formed, underground conspiracies, that are formed by, in particular, military officers and other and civil bureaucrats. This leads to the Constitutional Revolution of 1908, where there was a mutiny in July of 1908 by a number of military officers, the mutiny against the Sultan. And effectively, what they do is they force the Abdulhamid II to reinstate the Ottoman constitution. Now, these are officers who belong to an underground group that is known as the Committee of Union and Progress. And they're often referred to, I refer to the Constitutional Revolution of 1908. Many of you have probably more likely heard of the Young Turk Revolution of 1908. Young Turk is really a misnomer. This is a group that referred to itself, they didn't refer to themselves as Young Turks. They referred to themselves as Unionists. That is, they were members of this Committee of Union and Progress. And as the title of the organization suggests, their goals were two. One was the preservation of the empire and all its elements, that is union. And this was to be achieved through a progressive reform, progressive essentially meaning European-style rationalized reforms. Now, the significance, as I mentioned, that the members of this organization were predominantly military officers and civil bureaucrats. And that's significant, I think, for two reasons. It's significant because they identified very, very strongly with the Ottoman state, and their commitment to the preservation of the Ottoman state was for them really something akin to a sacred goal. And this is, I think, for two reasons. One is that their professional careers depended on it. As military officers will identify with the state for which they were fighting, generally speaking, very quite passionately. Moreover, these officers, the young officers, had been waging counterinsurgency campaigns in the Balkans at the end of the 19th century, in the beginning of the 20th century. That is, they're spilling their blood, they're seeing their friends losing their lives and trying to preserve this empire. So to them, this is something very near and very dear to their hearts. The second reason that it's important to look at the membership of this empire is that as research has shown more recently, they were disproportionately represented among the members of this of the Unionists were descendants of either people who were born in the Balkans themselves and in Western Anatolia, that is again these territories, because they saw either experienced them, either were children of parents who had been expelled from the Balkans as the Ottoman Empire broke up here, or they themselves witnessed it. And in other words, they saw firsthand, they understood the price of Ottoman collapse. That is, again, to if you looking back at this map, you know, the heartland of the Ottoman Empire, in many ways, it's Western Anatolia and the Balkans. So the loss of territories in the Balkans is not equivalent to, let's say, the British withdrawal from India, where it's clearly understood, well, this is not this is not England. This is foreign territory. It's a colony. The Ottoman attitude towards the Balkans is quite different. This is their homelands. They had been there for 400 years and identified strongly with it. So in 1908, there's this revolution, restoration of the constitution, and effectively it's the effective end of Abdul Hamid II's power. Now, when the constitution is reintroduced, there's a great deal of rejoicing across ethnic lines, across confessional lines. You have mullahs, priests, rabbis joining together arm in arm, marching in the streets. Everyone thinks this is wonderful. We'll now have freedom. We'll now have progressive reform, and sort of all our problems will melt away. And that was the hope, sort of, of the Unionists themselves, that these problems, once we get rid of the Sultan, of Abdul Hamid II in particular, put an end to his despotism, sort of things will sort themselves out. Well, nothing of the sort happened. I'll touch a bit on some of the internal problems, but very shortly after they announced the constitution, not only are they not greeted with in the international sphere with any sort of a grace period, to the contrary, Austria announces the annexation of the province of Bosnia and Herzegovina, and Bulgaria, which had effectively been lost already in 1878, also formally announces that it has left the Ottoman sphere. So from the very beginning, they think we're going to save this empire, but then they realize this isn't going to be so easy. Then making things sort of going from bad to worse, in 1911, Italy decides that it wants to seize the provinces of Tripolitania and Cyrenaica, that's today's Libya, and begins a war in 1911. I might have pointed out that in 1878 as well, the Ottomans give up these territories to Russia. The British, in exchange for diplomatic support, demand Cyprus, and then the British effectively take control of Egypt in 1882. So you have this territory is still part of the Ottoman Empire. The Italians attack it. One might think, well, what can be done? This is so far from Istanbul. Is it really worth sort of the Ottomans trying to struggle for it? Well, in fact, a number of the officers and members of the Committee of Union and Progress volunteer to go fight in Libya, and they have to dress in disguise, travel overland through Egypt to Libya. Among them are Enver Pasha, who was the hero, I think I have a slide of him here, the hero of the 1908 revolution known as the Hero of Liberty. And another young officer that was there was somebody by the name of Mustafa Kemal, who later, of course, takes the name Ataturk. So they are committed to trying to resist the Italians. This is very unjust what the Italians have done. This is an essential part of our empire, Tripoli and Cyrenaica. And they go there, they fight for roughly a year. They have a substantial success in rallying the tribesmen, particularly the Sanusi of Tripoli and Cyrenaica, resisting the Italians. However, the Italians up the ante. They use their navy to attack Ottoman Ottoman targets throughout the Mediterranean. They also provoke the Ottomans to shut down the Black Sea Straits, which is something that worries Russia a great deal. Russia, at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, is very heavily dependent upon export. export of grain, oil coming from Baku, and increasingly minerals from the Caucasus. They need to get those out to world markets through the Black Sea Straits. So when, as a result of this war between Italy and the Ottoman Empire, when the Ottomans shut down the straits, the Russians knew, of course, the straits are important for us, but they're becoming economically even more and more important to the Russian Empire due to its economic development in the south of Russia. And this is something that provokes further Russian concern about what's going on, the future of the Ottoman Empire. Now, the peace treaty is signed between the Ottoman Empire and Italy in 1912. So the Ottomans have to, they effectively lose the war. They have to cede these territories. And right as they conclude their treaty with the Italians, things get still worse. They are now attacked by the Balkan states in their last major possessions in the Balkans. So there's a surprise attack by the Balkan states, and this is a disaster. It's a total rout of the Ottoman army. It's what makes it on the field. It's a rout. But what makes it even worse for the Ottomans is that they're defeated not by major powers such as the Russians, not by the British or even the Italians, but they're defeated by their former imperial subjects. That is essentially their third-rate powers, the Serbians, the Bulgarians, the Greeks. And in addition to that, following the wars are famous for a great number of massacres. The wars conclude with the expulsion of roughly estimated 400,000 Muslims are ethnically cleansed from the Balkans, and they're sent, you have streams of refugees pouring into Anatolia. Now, this wasn't a completely new thing, as the Russian Empire had been expanding towards the Caucasus. You had, into the Crimea, you had waves of refugees washing up in Anatolia throughout the 19th century, both from the Caucasus, Crimea, and the Balkans. The point here being is this process is continuing, and in fact, it's getting worse. And the Ottomans are left with, at the beginning in 1914, are left with just this rump territory in the Balkans. So going into 1914, the Ottomans, despite all their efforts to save their empire, things are only continuing to get worse. Now, Russia, I mentioned that Russia had been worried by the war over Tripoli and Cyrenaica. Russia's much more worried by what happens in the Balkan Wars. And as I mentioned, one of the things about the Balkan Wars was the way that they showed the weakness of the Ottomans, that they were defeated not by major powers, but by minor ones. And this shakes up the Russians quite a bit, because although everyone knows at the end of the Ottoman Empire, or believes, I should say, rather, that the Ottoman Empire is going to be extinguished sooner or later, it's mainly a question of time, the possibility that maybe not the British or the French or the Germans, but in fact maybe the Greeks or the Bulgarians might get hold of Istanbul, Constantinople, and dominate the Straits becomes something that's quite worrisome for Russia. So one big concern of the Russian Empire is that the Straits might fall into hostile hands. The second concern that the Russians have is that essentially the Ottoman Empire, the fear was going to become what we today we call a failed state. And just as people referred to, as people in the United States referred to failed states as areas where disorder and terrorism in particular can breed, the Russians are very worried about what's going on in this part of the Ottoman Empire, Eastern Anatolia, which borders what Russian foreign minister, Sergei Sazonov, referred to as Russia's turbulent Caucasus. This is a territory controlled by Russia, but in which there have been periodic rebellions. It was a long struggle in the 19th century for the Russians to conquer it. They are quite worried about the possibility that with the breakup of the Ottoman Empire, or as the Ottoman Empire falls into chaos, one, you will have increased raids by nomads, primarily Muslims, into the Caucasus, which has a large Muslim population, and that will create problems for the Russians. They're also very worried about Armenian revolutionaries. You have Armenians living in the Ottoman Empire, Russian Empire, and in northern Iran. Many of them are well-organized and are part of the revolutionary movement inside of Russia. And the Russians are afraid that this area can be used, will be used by, again, nomads to conduct raids, which is destabilizing enough, but also they see the possibility that there could be a protracted campaign of subversion waged by Armenian revolutionary groups. Now, that's bad enough in itself, but they're also worried that this territory of Eastern Anatolia, where there is increasing European involvement, many consulates are open there, you have merchants there, you have missionaries, and there is jostling between all the great powers and sort of their representatives, as you have the British are there, the French, the Russians, of course, and the Germans. And the Russians are worried about all three of these in particular, the British, the French, and the Germans. So now the adding complicating things in Eastern Anatolia was the fact that you have a significant population of Armenians there. You also have a large number of Kurds. And there is, in fact, the dominant element in this part of Anatolia are the Kurds. Now, what's significant about the Kurds, without going into too many details, the Kurds are primarily living as nomads at the time, and they had been used to living largely outside of Istanbul's control. That part of the empire had been something of a backwater, and they had been permitted more or less to run things the way they had been wanted to run, as they wished. Sultan Abdul Hamid II, when there was a possibility that he might lose this the loyalty of the Kurds, the way he secures it is not by cracking down on them, but in fact something very much the opposite. He reaches out to them and enables tribal chiefs to set up regiments. These are known as the Hamidiye, named after Abdul Hamid. Hamidiye regiments, where he gives them, enables the tribal chiefs to establish these regiments, gives them money, gives them weapons, uniforms, and says, look, if you're loyal to me, I'll let you form these regiments, keep them as your own, and essentially you can do what you want with them. When he is effectively toppled from power, this new group that comes in, particularly, again, the Committee of Union Progress, their vision is that if we're going to save this empire, we need to establish centralized rule. We need to, in particular, we need to start taxing people, maximize the revenue out of the territories that remain, and we need to start putting people, conscripting them. Now, taxation and conscription are two things that I think are often universally resented, and that's not very popular with the Kurds. So with the toppling of Abdul Hamid II creates dissension among a lot of Kurdish tribal leaders. Also, the Kurds see a growing problem with the Armenian population there. The Armenians are roughly about 25% of the population. They are primarily, predominantly peasants living on land that the Kurds regard as owned by the Kurds, and the Armenians are essentially living effectively as serfs. Now, you have a classic kind of tensions between settled peoples and nomadic peoples. That's a tension that goes back to the time of the Bible, if not before. But you have, it begins to change things in the beginning of the 20th century, or really it's towards the end of the 19th century when they begin to change, but it accelerates in the 20th century, is that the Armenians are beginning to, their economic position is beginning to improve, because they have much higher rates of literacy. Virtually all males, by 1914, all male Armenians are literate, as opposed to well under 10% and probably under 5% for the Kurds. The Armenians are beginning to form nascent banking classes. They have merchants and semi-industrial classes as well. So the Kurds see this traditional relationship that we had, where we were the overlords of this region, is changing. And it's changing. We can see the Armenians below us are gaining in economic power, or beginning, their conditions are improving. Ours, however, are going downhill. Not only that, but we have this government in Istanbul that's not very sympathetic to our needs. So one of the things they do is when the CUP comes to power and disbands these Hamidiye tribal regiments, they cross the borders. A number of them go across the borders into northern Iran, which is occupied by Russia, and into the Caucasus, and they begin collaborating with the Russians. So you have the emergence beginning particularly around 1910, and it accelerates following the Balkan Wars, a covert Russian program to work with the Kurds. Now, the Russians, why are the Russians interested in the Kurds? Because one, they realize they are the dominant element in this part of Eastern Anatolia. We want to make sure that this area is more or less under our influence so that no one else can get in there and subvert our rule in the Caucasus. And we're also worried about this possibility of a threat from the Armenian revolutionaries, and the Kurds are a good counterweight against them. So with the Ottoman loss in the Balkan Wars, which really shook up the Russians to see this empire might be torn apart, not by us or the British, but perhaps by, again, these minor powers, we need to make sure that we can protect our interests in the empire. And they resurrect the so-called Armenian question, which had been put on the table of diplomats formally in 1878, again after the Russo-Ottoman War of 1877-78. As a result of that war, one of the obligations, I shouldn't say obligations, rather, it's a better way to phrase it, is that the great powers were given the prerogative to intervene in Ottoman affairs if the security of the lives and properties of Armenians was not guaranteed against the depredations of Kurds and Circassians. Circassians essentially refers to peoples from the Caucasus, Muslims who had been settled in Anatolia. So in 1913, the Russians began demanding from the Ottomans that they conduct reforms in Eastern Anatolia that will will be overseen by the Russians and that will guarantee Armenians the security of the Armenians. That negotiations go on for roughly a year, and finally in February 1914, the Ottomans, they try to argue against this as best they can, but they are forced to conclude an agreement wherein they permit international administrators to come in and effectively take over six provinces in the east of in eastern Anatolia. And this is seen by everybody at the time, by the Ottomans, by the Russians, by the British, by the Germans, as this is the next step towards the annexation of this territory by Russia. That is, it's not seen as a temporary measure, but this is merely setting the stage for the final dismemberment of the Ottoman Empire. So that's going into 1914. And the point here is that the leadership of the empire has seen itself, despite its best efforts at reform, it's constantly buffeted by great power predation from the outside and from what they see as great power exploitation of internal rifts inside of the Ottoman Empire. And they see their empire is only going down the tubes, and we aren't even getting an honest chance to stop this. So when war breaks out in 1914, in the summer, the Ottomans see this as perhaps an opportunity. Not an opportunity to get involved in the war, but rather this is an opportunity finally for us not to be victims, but maybe we can actually make ourselves worthwhile as an ally to one of these major combatants. So they begin talking with all of the major players, with the Germans, with the British, with the Russians, and with the French about the possibility of alliance with all of them. Many of these countries kind of scoff at the idea the Ottomans are going to be significant. After all, this is an empire that couldn't defend itself against middling minor Balkan states. What use could it be during the war? The Ottoman Minister of War, and coming back to, this way, Enver Pasha, this is a picture of him now. It's a cadet on the left. He's Minister of War, makes himself Minister of War in 1914, had served as attaché in Germany. He's very keen on alliance with Germany, and in August 2nd, he signs a secret treaty with Germany. But what's interesting about this treaty is that it obliges Germany to protect the Ottoman Empire for 5 years, which is this. The Ottomans see this as a huge achievement. We now have a great power patron who will protect us. So that will give us 5 years of peace, and we can finally undertake the reforms that we need to put our empire back together. It does not obligate the Ottomans to go to war for the Germans. And the Ottoman hope is throughout the summer of 1914 that this war, we've got what we want. If this war, expectations of the war will be short, the war will end, and at the end of it, we will have this treaty of alliance with Germany. And the idea, why Germany? The one is that the Germans had already been aiding the Ottoman military, so there was sustained cooperation between the Ottoman army and the German military. This wasn't unusual. The British were helping out the Ottoman Navy. The French were helping out the Ottoman gendarmes. But the army-to-army alliances are quite strong. You had Enver Pasha, who spoke German, had served in Germany, and was very impressed by the Germans. He saw, as did many Ottomans, and I would agree with this, Germany is a great ally. One, looks like an excellent ally. It's rich, it's powerful, it's very advanced, and arguably it's the dominant power in Europe, and a very good likelihood that it's going to be the dominant power in the world. So if you're going to choose allies, you might as well get the biggest guy on the block. Number two, and this is also quite significant, Germany was the one great power with no immediate pretensions on Ottoman territory. And that was something also the Ottomans valued very much. The Germans are far away. Make an alliance with the Russians, they're right on their doorstep. The British they're in Egypt, they're playing around in the Levant, they're also in the around the Arabian Peninsula. Likewise, the French, too, are mucking around here. The Germans are farther away. They are the better choice. And that essentially is why the Ottomans throw in their lot with the Germans. Later, of course, and they entered the war in full stop for the Germans in October of 1914, after the Germans had been cajoling them and saying, we're not going to continue to give you money unless you actually get in this war and do something. And with that, why don't I end and open it to questions. Yes. Right. No, I did that because I didn't want to. I could go into many, many details. So this is two effectively battle cruisers that were German. And they ended up fleeing into the Ottomans permitted, after hostilities broke out between Germany and Great Britain, the Ottomans permit the Goben, the Breslau, to take safe harbor in Istanbul. And then they actually reflag the ships as Ottoman warships. And this is a clear sign that the Ottomans are almost certainly going to be on the German side. Now, why did that happen? The more important, I think, is the greater logic of the Ottoman alliance with Germany. But there was another factor which really damaged any potential that Great Britain might have had in allying with the Ottomans. And that was the Ottomans had paid for two battleships that, in fact, had been completed and were about to be delivered to the Ottomans. They had paid the British to build them. The British, on the eve of the war, Winston Churchill in particular, understandably, we can see the logic of Churchill's thinking. We've got two beautiful, big, major battleships here. Would it be a wise thing to hand them over to the Ottomans? We don't know whose side they're going to be on. Moreover, we might need these ourselves in the war with Germany, and does not give them to the Ottomans. And this was something that the Ottomans bought and paid for these ships. Moreover, though, they also had paid for them through popular subscription. So you had women doing things like donating, cutting off their hair to donate, to raise money for this, donating jewelry. This is there's a good deal of popular involvement. And again, the Ottoman Empire is not a very wealthy empire, to the contrary. So they had to pay quite a bit to afford to buy these battleships, and then they don't get them from the British. The Germans have these two battlecruisers out there. They're getting chased, and the idea comes up, hey, let's give them over to the Ottomans, and we'll reflag them. That's a way of tying the Ottomans closer to the Germans and saving these ships from the British. But it's an important event, but it's not an absolutely... I think the more important is the overall logic that drives the Ottomans towards the Germans. Yes, here?
Sort of related to that, the British, a few years earlier, decided to convert their fleet, battle fleet, to coal and oil.
Mm-hmm.
They're very much interested in oil reserves that are in Iran and in the Middle East. Why did they have treaties with the Ottomans to be able to take that without having to go to war and actually invade later on in the war? Why did they make the deal?
So the question is why the British have switched their fleet to fueling with oil. They need oil resources in the Middle East, so why didn't the British say ally with the Ottomans and know, therefore, that we have secure access to oil. I think the answer to that question sort of, you said the British had their eyes on oil in Iran. And so they don't really need the Ottomans for that. More generally, the British, and Churchill in particular, didn't put much weight on the empire. The Ottoman Empire scene is not really worth dealing with that seriously, because it's going to go, again, probably sooner rather than later. And I think that's the British didn't see an alliance with the Ottomans anyway being crucial to them, either for refueling their fleet or for anything else, any other reason. Right, but I don't, and someone can correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't know that the British had any major problems with fueling their fleet during the war that the Ottomans might have helped them out with. Someone can correct me if I'm wrong, but I've never come across that.
Professor Reynolds, your next question is from the gentleman in the red.
Yes.
Rationally, you would think that the Russians would want to make the Ottomans right a deal they couldn't refuse to keep those straits open, right? And the Russians had the most to lose. So why couldn't the Russians give the Ottomans a deal they couldn't refuse?
That's an excellent question. Part of it is the Russians actually did say. I think ultimately it comes down to the Ottomans understood that as well. I mean, the Ottomans. Their belief is that the Russians are our greatest enemy. They are the greatest existential threat. They've been the greatest one throughout the 19th century. It begins before that. And the Russians were not, if you reading the correspondence between Russian military officials and diplomats, they didn't really think the Ottomans were going to be a major factor in the war. There was discussion of between both Sazonov and the ambassador both believed that, yes, it would be a good thing to keep the Ottomans out of the war. And in fact, if I recall correctly, I think it's the ambassador writes, let's just promise them anything they want to keep them out of the war. And then we'll find an excuse after the war to just grab the straits. I think the Russian belief, I mean, when the Ottomans understood that the Russians are going to want to grab these territories from us, again, probably sooner rather than later. And the Russians weren't all that. They didn't make. I mean, despite the fact that let's promise them anything they want, there was no evidence that I've looked at. The Russians. There were negotiations, but the Russians never gave a serious effort to trying to convince the Ottomans to stay out of the war by trying to come up with some reason to keep them out. But I think they certainly regretted that. At the end of. The Russian ambassador leaves Istanbul in 1914, and he predicts when he comes back it's going to be a Russian city. Of course, then you have the Russian Revolution, and one of the things that happens in 1918 as a result of the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk is that an independent Ukraine is recognized. And the Ottomans they love this idea of an independent Ukraine. And when they welcome the new Ukrainian ambassador to Istanbul, they crow about it in newspapers about how when the Russian ambassador left Istanbul, he declared that when he comes back, it's going to be a Russian city. But rather than that having happened, instead, we are greeting the new Ukrainian ambassador.
Your next question is from back in the back.
Yes.
What caused the Ottomans to close the straits in 1911 when that would provoke and injure Russia a great deal more than Italy when they were fighting a war with Italy in what's now Libya?
Yeah, excellent question. Part of that was the Ottomans were trying to send the signal of, look, someone's got to help us out, which didn't really work too effectively. All it did was it simply raised. Again, the Russians were aware that we're dependent upon the straits and our dependency is growing. But rather than getting really any, the Russians didn't step in and tell the Italians to knock it off. But that had been essentially the Ottomans were hoping there'd be more of that reaction.
Many books talk about Enver Pasha being interested in a pan-Turkic movement. So did that have any impact on their decision to support Germany also?
In fact, no. That's one of the greatest myths, and I've written at length pointing out how there's really no basis for that belief. That is, this is the belief that the Ottoman Empire in 1914 saw itself, that the Ottomans saw themselves as losing their old empire, but they're on the verge of perhaps gaining a new empire in the Caucasus and Central Asia, an empire organized more along on the lines of ethnicity and Turkic ethnicity in particular, and that they believe that this is a possibility, and therefore, fools that they are, they joined the Germans when, had they stayed out of the war, they could have kept their old empire. I'm tempted to say complete nonsense. Enver, if you look at what he wrote and what he was thinking and what those around him were thinking, they knew very, very well, better than anyone, how precarious the position of their empire was. They had no visions of them expanding in any significant fashion into the Caucasus or let alone Central Asia. In fact, Enver informs his generals on the eve of the war that most likely we don't know if we can count on the Turkic peoples inside the Caucasus. They're probably going to sit out this war, and the Circassians actually are likely to support the Russians. They look, and because they study this question, whether the various peoples we might be able to appeal to inside of Russia, they look at maybe we can get the Cossacks. They understand there's tension between Jews and Russian authorities. They even look into that. And the initial, actually, Ottoman plan for initiating war against the Russian Empire is to start with an amphibious invasion. In other words, not a land invasion through the Caucasus, but rather to look into the possibility of an amphibious invasion of the south of Russia. Of course, they realized very soon after meeting with the Germans and the Austrians that there simply wasn't the naval sea lift to get them across the Black Sea. But the idea that the Ottomans, it's vastly, vastly exaggerated, the idea that Enver really thought they were going to have a new empire. And that's really demonstrated when you look at 1918, when the Russian Empire is effectively falling apart, and the Ottoman Empire is the only major player in this. Actually, I have maps from that period. And the Ottomans are the only major player here. And they, in fact, are able to send forces to Baku, and then on to Derbent, and then ultimately up to Port Petrovsk. This is the very end of World War I. But even at that point, with Russia effectively out of existence, effectively, they're thinking we're going to use this. We want to set up independent states that we will use as, that will serve as buffer states between us and Russia when there's going to be a negotiated settlement to this war.
Your next question is from Dr. John Kuhn.
Professor Reynolds, thank you. That was a very wonderful presentation. And as you kind of went through all the detail there, it's sort of the idea that we can go back to Mike Nyberg's discussion of sort of this reductionist Maine thing as being unhelpful. And I thought about, you know, we're really talking about the breakup of empires here, and in this case, the Ottoman Empire. The other thing that hit me was that all politics are local, that there's all these local things along the periphery of the Ottoman Empire that have a deep, deep, long history that just doesn't go away in 1914, but kind of comes to fruition. How much of that sort of the exterior of the Ottoman Empire and this sort of breakup do you think is useful as kind of using as a causal factor for the war?
For World War I, I think it's essential. I mean, as Dr. Nyberg suggested, you might think of the World War I as a Third Balkan War. This is the one, it's a vacuum. This is the Eastern question. Everyone knows the Ottoman Empire is weak, and the question is who's going to dominate it? And this generates a great deal of rivalry between the great powers, and not necessarily out of aggression. I mean, looking at Russia, for example, one thing that struck me, from the Ottoman perspective, the Russians are aggressors, they're breathing down our necks, they want to grab this territory. When you start looking at what the Russian officials themselves were arguing and discussing, many of them actually did not want to get this territory in the Caucasus. Their fear was really, in Anatolia, their fear was that we're vulnerable down here. If we have another standoff with the British and the French, there's the Crimean War, know, they realized this is our, remember, the Crimean War is fought in Crimea, and you have the British and French essentially fighting on Russian territory, and something like that. And then the Russians realized this could be used against us. We're vulnerable down here. We could get tied down in an altercation with the British or with the French. I mean, they begin to see the French as major rivals in the Eastern Mediterranean. They're worried about the French Navy. They're very much worried about French activity here in Anatolia. So they see themselves as vulnerable here. And they are looking to this territory as an area that we need to, whether we want to or not, we need to make sure that we have it under our control in some fashion, because it can be used against us. Likewise, the Straits as well, they're very much worried about others. The Germans, for example, this is, I didn't mention it, but in 1914, one of the things that adds to the crisis over between the Ottomans and the Russians over what's going on in Eastern Anatolia with the Armenians is the fact that for a brief moment, a German officer is, von Sanders, yes, is to be put in charge of Ottoman forces on the Straits, and the Russians see this as extremely provocative and hostile act. But you know, one of the things with the you know, as the Russians look at the Armenian question, one of their statesmen points out is that, you know, we have a large Armenian population, which is already problematic for us in the Russian Empire. We now occupy northern Iran, and the last significant Armenian population that's outside of our control is inside the Ottoman Empire. If we take this territory, we've got all the Armenians under us. And guess who's going to be the main enemy? Because the Armenians had this problem. Who's our main problem? Is it the Ottomans or is it the Russians? And many, actually, Russians thought, we're only going to get more problems if we go into Anatolia. But the fear that, the British, the French, or the Germans would get in there and use this against us is one of the things, okay, we've got to assert control over this area. And even more so, of course, the Straits.
Can you give me a couple of groups on Albania and its importance in the breakup of the Ottoman Empire, as well as increasing tension in the Balkans?
Albania, the loss of Albania, when Albania declares its independence from the Ottoman Empire, that scene is sort of a, because the Albanians predominantly Muslim, and that's just sort of adding insult to injury. When the Muslims too leave the empire, but aside from that, Albania is not a major factor in, because the Ottomans are losing so much territories in the Balkans that it's not really a critical factor. I might point out that Enver Pasha, the Ottoman Minister of War, was himself part Albanian. So again, sort of the loss of these territories, and underscore this is not distant colonies that the Ottomans have lost, but their own homes. And many of them actually describe it that way. So, you know, they've lost their homes. You know, Mustafa Kemal, later Ataturk, of course, was born in Salonika, Thessaloniki, and he saw his own hometown lost.
Your next question is from the middle.
You've spoken about Germany being allied with the Ottoman Empire. How do the Ottomans see themselves in the relationship with Austria, especially considering that Austria has just annexed Bosnia, which it had a protectorate over?
It's sort of, I think the Austrians, they're a package deal. They come with the Germans, so we'll deal with it. Nothing that I've read had expressed too much any thinking, either negatively or positive, towards the Austro-Hungary. I think because at that time, the Austrians grabbed Bosnia and Herzegovina, but it had effectively been lost by the Ottomans long before 1908. But this is just losing in 1908 is just a demonstration we're never going to get these territories back. No one's going to say, okay, we've restored the administration, we'll hand them back over to the Ottoman Empire. But there was no tremendous animosity towards Austria-Hungary. Likewise, I would point out after the Balkan Wars, which are famous for being often described as wars of ethnic wars, where there are massacres of civilian populations, very, very nasty war. Well, right after that war, the Ottomans established a treaty of alliance with the Bulgarians. And it's amazing to read the descriptions of when they meet to sign this alliance. There's genuine joy and happiness when they have a dinner to celebrate, the banquet. And the Ottomans and the Bulgarians get along great. because they realize we've got something in common now after the first Balkan Wars. So it's not anything that needs to be downplayed. This is sort of a notion of, in particular, the Ottomans are often seen as being motivated by effectively primitive allegiances based on a religion or on ethnicity. And likewise, this is often used in describing Balkan history as well. And here we have the Bulgarians and the Turks, or the Ottomans, are able to, after this very nasty war with them, able to establish an alliance, and they maintain that alliance then through World War I. And so with Austria, it's even easier.